Father, we thank you and praise you for the day and its many blessings. We thank you for who you are, what you are to us. We give honor and glory to your name. Father, we pray you're blessed now, this time that we have to worship together. Father, give us a sense of joy and worship and just a belonging to you. And Father, that we may open our hearts and minds to your word. Give Brother Crow the words that we need to hear, that we may be what you would have us to be, that we can open our hearts and minds and receive your word and take it and apply it to our daily lives. Forgive us where we fail. You guide us and use us for Jesus' sake and for his blessed name. Amen.
Amen. Hebrews 10, verses 24 and 25 tell us, "Let us consider one another in order to stir up love and good works, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together, as in the manner of some, but exhorting one another, and so much the more as you see the day approaching." Good morning. It's great to see everyone together as we gather to worship the Lord this morning. We are grateful for everyone to be here, and let's stand as our ushers comes and Brother Reed leads us in the singing of the doxology this morning.
Let's sing together.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above the heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. So
much. Praise team, lead us in worship this morning. It's good for heart and soul. Open your Bible, if you would, in the Old Testament again this week, and back to the book of Joshua one more time, this time to chapter 2. If you happen to be on our one call list, you got a message on Friday that we're going to eventually get to the book of Ruth. And that's the next book I'm looking forward to preaching all the way through. Last Sunday, we looked at Joshua 1 as kind of a new beginning in the book of Joshua and in our calendar year. And I was going to go ahead and start Ruth today, and then I kind of realized, well, here in chapter 2, we have a great story that actually leads directly to the book of Ruth. And that story is about Rahab. And how it connects to the book of Ruth is Boaz, who is one of the main characters in the book of Ruth, his mom is Rahab. And might or might not have known that, but it's going to connect the two together here. But again, I'm looking forward to starting in Ruth. Next week's a great Old Testament book, not very long. Be great for you to start reading this week and spending some time in if you have an opportunity to do that. Our first Sunday of the new year, 52 times a year, we get together as God's people in the Lord's house on the day, the first day of the week, reminding us His resurrection happened on the first day of the week. This is our day to worship and glorify the Lord. And I thank you very much for being here this morning, and I pray that you had a good and godly week before your time here. Chapter 1 of the book of Joshua, the title of the message this morning is Rahab's Rope, which we'll get to here in just a few minutes. If you would, stand with me and honor the reading of God's holy and perfect word today. From Joshua, the second chapter, and I'm going to read the first seven verses for us this morning as we start studying God's word. It says, "Now Joshua, the son of Nun, sent two men as spies secretly from Shittim, saying, 'Go and view the land, especially Jericho.' So they went, and they came to the house of a harlot whose name was Rahab, and they lodged there. It was told the king of Jericho, saying, 'Behold, men from the sons of Israel have come here tonight to search out the land.' And the king of Jericho sent word to Rahab, saying, 'Bring out the men who have come to you and have entered your house, for they have come to search out all the land.' But the woman had taken the two men and hidden them. And she said, 'Yes, the men came to me, but I did not know where they were from.' It came about when it was time to shut the gate at dark that the men went out. I do not know where the men went. Pursue them quickly, for you will overtake them. But she had brought them up to the roof and hidden them in the stalks of flax, which she had laid in order on the roof. So the men pursued them on the road to the Jordan, to the fords, and as soon as those who were pursuing them had gone out, they shut the gate." Let's pray this morning. Father, speak into our willing hearts this morning. As we have sung your praise together, Lord, you are worthy of our worship and our admiration. And I thank you for the sound of God's people lifting their voice to praise the amazing grace we've been given. Father, I pray now that we would continue to worship in spirit and in truth. And God, may this truth of your word be planted in our heart, that it would take root, that it would grow, and it would yield fruit in each one of our lives. Father, thank you for this Old Testament example of what it means to have faith. May we hear it this morning and apply it to our hearts and to our lives. Father, we love you and we trust you, and we pray together as a church in the name of Jesus Christ. And all God's people would say, and you may be seated again this morning. I'm sure this is a very familiar story to you. Rahab is well known. She's not mentioned in a lot of places, but she's mentioned in Scripture here in the book of Joshua, of course. And she's alluded to, or the word is other places in the Old Testament, usually referring to a nation of people. But then she shows up in three places in the New Testament. One of those is in the lineage, the genealogy of Jesus Christ. Maybe an odd place we would think for someone who is called here in Scripture a harlot to show up, but right there she is, directly in line to Jesus Christ. She shows up in the book of Hebrews, chapter 11, the great hall of faith where God's people are called out for their great faith, saying, "By faith Rahab the prostitute did not perish with those who were disobedient because she had given a friendly welcome to the spies." And then she appears in the book of James, one of the most practical books in the entire Bible, literally a living out of her faith. Not too bad for someone who the rest of the world would look at and say, "I don't know that I want anything to do with her. She's a harlot. She's a prostitute. She has uncertain background for sure." The first premise I would have us note this morning is every one of us are saved by the same exact grace that Rahab was saved by. Would you agree with that? She's not better or worse than any of us. We're not better or worse than she is. In fact, we are exactly where she is. She lives a life to follow Jehovah God. In the same way, if we're going to be a follower of Jesus, if our life is going to go after Jesus, some things that were true in her life are going to be true in ours. And here's a sentence for you. A life of faith as a follower of Jesus is full of risk. It takes a response from us. It grows in reliance as we go forward and eventually brings us rest. Those four words I'm going to come back to. A life of faith following Jesus is full of risk, takes a response, it grows in reliance on Him, and it ultimately brings us to rest. As I mentioned, this is the first of 52 times we'll gather. None of us in the room know what those 52 weeks will bring. Maybe you had a great first week of 2024, and if you did, I'm proud for you. Amen. But if you didn't, maybe next week will be better. But the truth of the matter is, maybe next week won't be better. Maybe around us it'll be more difficult and worse. We simply don't know those things. We don't know a lot of our circumstances. What we can know and what we can take a refuge in is that we know Jesus Christ. And we know that whatever we may face, whatever we may go through, Jesus will go with us and be there with us as we go through those things. I've been praying for a family this week. We mentioned them Wednesday night in our prayers. A man named Tony Robinson, who was one of the first people I met when I started working at Conway Christian back in 2004. Great, just a goofball. Loved Jesus, loved his family, loved those kids at school. He'd come watch them play all sorts of sports. Went home to be with the Lord this week. I'm sure that's not what his wife had planned, or his son. That's not what they desired for their Christmas and New Year's to be like. But at the same time, even though there's heartache and there's difficulty there, I know from talking to them, there's hope and there's joy knowing that Tony is in heaven. This year, some of us will have great mountaintop experiences and things will be really good. And some of us will be in the valley and the difficult experiences. And some of us may be in both places before the year goes. The story of Rahab is a reminder that if we're really going to follow God and do what He says, there's going to be risk involved. There's going to be difficulty involved. But there is a reward at the other end. Three things I want you to notice about Rahab. Number one is her story. The story of Rahab. Start with me in the end of verse 1. Joshua sends these two spies, and the end of verse 1 says, they went and came to the house of a harlot whose name was Rahab, and they lodged there. Now, we don't know if they knew she was a harlot. We just know that when they were doing their spy work, this is where they got to. Rahab lived in Jericho. She lived on the outer walls of Jericho, we're told by the rest of this story. So I don't know if they knew. In fact, I would probably lean to the fact they probably didn't know she was a harlot when they got there, that she was a biblical prostitute. But I do know this, that's exactly where God intended them to go. That's exactly the house God wanted them to be in because of the way the rest of the story goes. So they go to spy and they go to hide in this place. And verse 2 says, it was told by the king of Jericho saying, behold, men from the sons of Israel have come here tonight to search out the land. Here's a news flash. God's people aren't very good spies. They fail. They're not good at being sneaky. They're not good at lying. They're not good at kind of weaving and getting there. Literally, the day they get there to go spy out this land, the king says, hey, I saw them. Like, they're here. Go get them and let's arrest them. Let's get rid of them. You know, let's execute them, whatever. This guy was the king of Jericho. Kings like this were notoriously kind of ill-tempered. They like to run stuff. He was in charge of this little city-state of Jericho, probably had a small army, and so he would be him against the world sort of mentality. And so they fail, but while they fail, Rahab hides them. The king says, go get them, and Rahab says, well, I did see them, but they went out another way. Now, I want you to note something right here before we go forward. The Bible never gives Rahab a boy for lying. This is not an inclusion for us to say, well, as God's people, sometimes we can lie if it turns out okay. No. Our God is a God of truth. Amen? We're to always speak the truth. What she did do is have faith that God would take care of her if she was obedient. Had she not lied, I fully believe God would have delivered these spies in another way. a supernatural way. In fact, we may even miss out on that because of what she did. But she did tell them, I saw them, but they went another way, and she had hidden them on her roof. Much like we talked about a couple weeks ago with Bathsheba, it probably would have been a square house, and up on top of the roof, you would lay out these leaves of flax and let the sun beat down on them to dry them out to use them for whatever purpose you would want. And so she took the spies up there, put them under the leaves, laid the leaves on top of them, and basically they hid there. Here's what I like about Rahab, though. She professes a faith in God. Go back to Scripture and look with me in verse number 8, right where we left off. So the police, so to speak, from Jericho have gone out the gates. They're trying to go find these men who are right there in their city. And now Rahab speaks. She comes up onto the roof and she says to the men, listen to what she says, verse 9. I know that the Lord has given you the land and that the terror of you has fallen on us and that all the inhabitants of the land have melted away before you. For we have heard how the Lord dried up the water of the Red Sea before you when you came out of Egypt, and what you did to the kings of the Amorites who were beyond the Jordan, to Shihon and Og, whom you utterly destroyed. And we heard it, our hearts melted. No courage remained in any man any longer because of you. For the Lord your God, he is God in heaven above and on the earth beneath. Woo! This harlot's got better theology than some of us. She knows who God is. She knows what God does. She knows his power and his strength and his majesty. She knows who God is, and I believe here she professes a faith in this God. She's like, we're done. If God wants y'all in here, you're going to be in here, and we know that. We've seen what God has done before, and we believe that God can do it again. And so she's just telling them, the reason I hid you is because I believe that God is with you, and he's going to take care of you. So now she asks for something in verse 12. Please swear to me by the Lord, since I have dealt kindly with you, that you will deal kindly with my father's household and give me a pledge of truth. Spare my father, my mother, my brothers, my sisters, and all who belong to them, and deliver our lives from death. She knew that God's people were going to take over this land, and she also knew that God had said that the Canaanites and those people in the land couldn't live with God's people. And so God's people had a right by a sovereign God to come in and do what he had commanded them by clearing out the land. So she knew what the future was going to hold. So she asked for something. She says, since I have dealt kindly with you, basically deal kindly with me. Prid pro quo. I'll scratch your back, you scratch mine. I'll do something for you, now you do something for me. And the spies tell her in verse 14, our life for yours if you do not tell this business of ours. And it shall come about when the Lord gives us the land that we will deal kindly and faithfully with you. Verse 15 says, so she let them down by a rope through the window, for her house was on the city wall, so that she was living on the wall. And she said to them, go to the hill country, so the pursuers will not happen upon you, and hide yourselves for 3 days until the pursuers return, and afterward you will go on your own way. Rahab's rope, that scarlet cord, that comes from her window that then has become a metaphor for preachers for years to say a scarlet cord, the blood of Jesus, weaves all the way through Scripture from Rahab all the way down to Christ. So she leaves these men out. She allows them to leave. Israel, in chapters 3, 4, and 5, Israel passes through the Jordan. God's people set up 12 stones. They circumcise all their men. They celebrate Passover. They do all those things. And then in chapter 6, Rahab's story comes back around. God's people come in and they march around the city. They do what God says. They don't fight. They don't try to attack them. They just march and sing God's praises when they have obeyed exactly what God said. Y'all know the story. The walls come tumbling down. And in Joshua chapter 6, verse 22, Rahab and her family are saved. This is the story of Rahab, an unlikely hero doing an unlikely thing. Going against a king that surely would have had no problem at all disposing of her quickly. I mean, being honest, he's the king and she's a harlot. He would have looked at her and thought nothing about just getting rid of her. Yet because of her faith, because of the knowledge she had about God, she was willing to obey, be obedient to God, take a risk for God, do what he called her to do, and she was rewarded because of that. Ultimately, she got the rest that the people in Jericho did not get. So that is her story. But secondly, I want to go back and dive a little deeper into her salvation, the salvation of Rahab. Let's look at that verse one more time because I think this is worth noting. In verse 10, it says, "We have heard how the Lord dried up the water of the Red Sea when you came out of Egypt, what you did to the kings of the Amorites who were beyond the Jordan, Sihon and Og, whom you destroyed." And she says a phrase at the start of verse 11, "When we heard it, our hearts melted, and no courage remained in any man any longer because of you. For the Lord your God, he is God, in heaven, above, and on the earth beneath." Rahab basically tells us this is what salvation ought to look like. Very, very quickly, look at all these things from these couple of verses. Number one, her faith was singular. It is just her. This isn't Rahab and a lot of her friends. This isn't all of her family saying, "We all have faith." This isn't a large group of people. This is Rahab, a woman by herself, living on the wall of Jericho, having a profession in which she probably doesn't have a whole lot of real, genuine friends or confidants or people to encourage her or support her. And here she is saying, "I alone, I have faith, and so I will do what I am supposed to do." A lot of us, myself included, would love for lots of other people to act certain ways and do certain things. And we should be reminded, before I look at anybody else and what they're doing, it starts with me. It starts with us as individuals. Yes, I would like a lot of other people to live certain ways and do certain things, but my first and biggest responsibility is me. I've only been here a few months, and I've had trouble with church members. Guess who? Me. I'm the worst church member here. I lie, I cheat, I always don't have a good attitude, I have all sorts of things that are going on with me. That's me. All of us should start there. Because that's how change happens. When you change, then other people change. The rest of Rahab's family gets saved from this death. How? Because of her faith. Her singular faith. Number two, it was self-denying. She said, "This may cost me my life, but I'm going to do this." Again, the king would have had no problem dealing with her. Verse 9, she says, "I know the Lord has given you the land, and the terror of you has fallen on us." Terror could be replaced with a word of reverence there. We know that your God is going to come in, and we know what's going to be the end of us. If we rebel against your God and your people, we know how that's going to end. She was willing to die to help the spies. Isn't that the basic call of a Christian? To come and die to yourself and live for Jesus Christ? So you cannot live your life for you. Now that's a weird sentence, isn't it? You say, well, of course we got to live our lives for ourselves. Who else would we live it for? You live it for Jesus Christ. Paul said in Galatians that it was no longer he who was alive, but that he was crucified with Christ so that Christ could live in him and through him. Rahab's faith was sympathizing. She didn't just care about herself. As soon as she realized what was happening to her, look what it says in verse 13. She begged for her life, but she also said, "And my father, and my mother, and my brothers, and my sisters." Meaning the people that she loved, she wanted them to be saved as much as she wanted to be saved. Salvation is not selfish. Salvation belongs to anyone that will receive it. And our desire as believers should be that more and more people hear it and know it and receive it. Her faith was stable. Now, we've already said the spies that were sent by Joshua, they're not so good, right? That's not in their nature. That's not what they did. Rahab was in a very dangerous situation. And she was able to battle her way through it, being stable. Twice in my life, I've had to be in a courtroom for a real issue. And one of those, I had to testify. Now, before you think, you know, hey, that's pretty cool, it was just our adoption hearings, okay? And to be completely truthful, Eli, how old was Eli? Like 2? He got kicked out of his own adoption hearing for being too loud. So let's just, you know, be honest about that. But we had to get up on the stand. You had to put your hand on the Bible and, you know, and testify. Do you want this child? Will you feed him? Which I had no idea what I was getting into when I said yes. And like, so even in that moment, that was the happiest, most low-key court situation ever. And guess what? I was scared to death on the witness stand. I was going to say something wrong or like do something incorrect and mess the whole thing up. Like I'm not built for high pressure situations, right? Can you imagine what Rahab was feeling? Again, just based on who she was, who's she going to call on to help her? You think she's going to get in front of the king and say, well, just go ask all these guys in town. They know I'm a good person. You think any of those guys are going to say they know her? You think anybody's going to say they know her? Anybody's going to vouch for her character? It was just her. But her faith in God didn't shake. Her faith in God didn't shake. I think we should be more in tune with that. No matter who wins an election, no matter what the price of anything becomes, no matter what happens around us as the people of Jesus, our faith cannot be shaken. God's still in control. Always has been and always will be. Her faith was stable. Her faith was, I believe, saving. She, her house, were the only survivors of Jericho. And then ultimately, her faith was sanctifying. Why was her faith sanctifying? Several reasons. Number one, I'm standing here talking about her from a pulpit this morning. Number two, she's in the lineage of Jesus Christ. We trace the lineage of Jesus, and Rahab is right there, bigger than Dallas. Right in the middle of it. The book of Hebrews says she was a pioneer of the faith. And the book of James says she lived out her faith in a very practical way. She was sanctifying. She literally went from the lowest you could go to here we are, revering her. From reviling her to revering her. I was reading one of my commentaries this week, and as I was studying, something that I read absolutely punched me in the gut. And I want you to hear it this morning. I want to be as kind as I can in saying it. There is really not a whole lot of difference in the activities of a prostitute and a loving spouse, except for the motivation. I read that this week, and I thought, what are they talking about? And they went on to describe it. What a spouse does and what a prostitute does, they're basically the same thing in a lot of senses, right? Except one is doing it only out of a sense of duty to receive money. And the other one is doing it out of a sense of unyielding love. And the reason it punched me so hard is I thought, how many times have I shown up to do the service of God so that He would bless me or fix me or help me with something? That worship and that discernment at that moment, that giving of myself when I was only expecting something in return, is no different than what a prostitute does, is it not? We don't worship Jesus out of a sense of duty or to gain something from Him. We worship Jesus out of an unyielding love for Him. That's the difference. It's not even the actions that were different. It's why she would do those actions. Rahab was not only saved, she was sanctified because she did those actions, not because she just wanted to receive something, but because she said, God is going to come in and we know He's going to win, and I want to be where He is when this thing is over. Which leads me to number three, the stature of Rahab. I started this message by saying that a life of faith as a follower of Jesus is full of risk, needs a response, grows in reliance, and ultimately brings us rest. Let's fact check that against the life of Rahab. Number one, is her life full of risk? Absolutely. She literally risked everything. She risked her life, her home, everything she had to hide these spies. She basically laid all of her cards on the table immediately, saying, I'm going to have faith that God's going to take care of me, before she talked to the spies. Now, it would be one thing if she said, okay, I'll hide you, but first tell me you're going to make it all right. That's not what happens in our passage, is it? First, she hides them. Then she goes and says, okay, now here's what I need. She obeys first. She has faith first, and then later on, that faith comes to pass. Following Jesus right now to a lot of our friends may seem like a risky move. It may not seem like the best thing. I've never known a time in our history that we can be more counterculture by following Jesus than we can right now. Go home, have a family, love each other, take care of each other, build your life right there. That's the opposite of everything our culture tells us to do. And so the world looks at it and says, that's crazy. Why would you do that? And he said, I'm going to risk it all for the cause of Jesus Christ. In Mark chapter 1, as Jesus is beginning to call his disciples, he sees two brothers, James and John, sons of Zebedee, and they're fishing with their nets. And y'all remember this story. Jesus walks by them, and he says, drop your nets and come follow me, and I'll make you what? Fishers of men. They dropped their nets. Didn't ask questions. Didn't want to see a prospectus. Ask about the retirement. What's all this involve? How much, you know, how long is this going to take? Jesus called them and they dropped their nets and they went with him. That's a life full of risk, is it not? The great missionary Jim Elliot, he is no fool who gives what he cannot keep to gain that which he cannot lose. Dear friend, if there's anything in your life that you're hanging on to, let it go. And give it to Jesus. It may feel like a risk, but I promise you, it's the best risk you'll ever take. Number two, I said that life following Jesus is full of risk, but takes a response. Rahab trusted the spies and had faith that the God of Israel was the one true God, that he would lay out his divine purpose. A walk of faith requires us to trust and Jesus to guide. Our job is to follow, to respond, to then do what he says. It's great to hear the call and say, ah, Jesus is calling me. Now it's up to us. How will we respond to it? Christianity has been described as a long obedience in the same direction, meaning day after day after day, we choose to follow Jesus. We choose and then we choose again and then we choose again and then we choose again. Back to my adoption story, over our fireplace hangs a big picture, and it simply has a quote on it that I will not be able to tell you the entire quote. But part of it says, I choose you, and tomorrow I will choose you again. Day by day by day, a response to Jesus is an obedient heart, willing to do what he calls us to that day. Number three, it grows in reliance. From chapter 2 to chapter 6, we don't hear a whole lot about Rahab. She's just there hoping things are going to work out. Now, I just picture her looking out the window on her wall. Now, and I don't know if this happened, so I'll step over here to say it, okay? Picture it with me, though. She's looking out her window. She's waiting for this great army to come and overthrow Jericho so that she'll survive and she'll be one of the few that make it, right? And so she sees them coming, and I'm sure she's excited. And then they all line up in a straight line, and I'm sure she's excited. And then they just start marching in a circle. And they start singing. And they go around once. Okay, maybe they're just getting ready. And then they go around again. Maybe they're just getting extra ready. And then a third time. And then a fourth time, and then now she's getting dizzy instead of them getting ready. They're just marching. They're not doing anything. And then they finally stop marching, and you know what they do? They blow all the trumpets, and they blow the horns at once, and that's their battle plan. And I don't know if she felt it or not, but for just a minute, put yourself in her shoes. Wouldn't you be like, uh-oh. But then the rumble started. Down at the base of the wall, the rumble starts. And then it grows and it grows and it grows. And the next time she looks out, the walls are completely gone. I don't know what that looks like in your life. I only know what it looks like in my life, but I know that the more we walk with Jesus, the more we learn about how faithful he is. That time after time after time, even when it doesn't look like it, he's faithful to us. Ultimately, a walk with Jesus brings us rest. Rahab was saved, Not only was she saved, she was hemmed into the lineage of Jesus Christ. A walk of faith gives us peace despite our circumstances. Rahab made the hall of faith in Hebrews chapter 11, where the great men and women of God are listed by faith, by faith, by faith, by faith. Abraham, Moses, Jacob, David, and Rahab, the prostitute from Jericho. Except now she's Rahab, the great woman of faith. She's not what she used to be. She's something different now entirely because of her faith in Jehovah. We have to know that Jesus says in John 14, "Peace I leave with you, peace I give to you." Not like the world gives, but a peace that I leave you, to let not your heart be troubled. A life of faith as a follower of Jesus takes risk, causes us to respond, makes us grow in reliance on Him, but ultimately it brings us to rest. And I don't just mean the rest of heaven, which one day we'll experience, and that will be beyond our mind's ability to comprehend. I mean the ability you have today to rest in the fact that if you have pleased God, nothing else really matters. If you're doing what God has called you to do, no terrible thing can take that away, and no good thing in this life would ever be better than that. That reliance, that rest, that hope, and knowing I am right where God wants me to be. Church, there is nothing better. God's will, nothing more, nothing less, and nothing else. Will you bow your heads for just a moment this morning? As we have just a moment before we go back out into this world to dwell on Rahab. As a father of a daughter, I often think about people that I want her to look up to, people that I want her to become like. You wouldn't think Rahab would be on that list, right? Oh, but what a difference the grace of God can make in a ready soul that is willing to be obedient to what they're called to do. All of us have been Rahab. All of us at some point in our spiritual life have done what God called us to do so that He would bless us or give us this or make this healthy or whatever. We've all done that. I've done that. I don't ever want to do that again, though. I want my spiritual life, that intimacy of spiritual life with Jesus, to be based on love and not on our reward. Father, this morning I pray that each and every one of us, God, that we would be reminded of this beautiful rope that Rahab put out the window. God, that as we get ready to have a moment of invitation this morning, that each of us would be willing and ready to respond. Lord, if there's business you have in our lives, in our families' lives, in any place, this is a great day to respond to that. Lord, give us the faith that Rahab possessed, knowing that no matter what, you are in control, you were in charge, and you had a plan. God, thank you for saving her. Thank you for saving a wretched sinner like me. Lord, help us all to take a risk, to respond to you, to grow closer to you day by day by day, and to rest in the fact that on the cross, you told us it is completely finished. Thank you for your redemptive work. Move in the hearts of those you've spoken to this morning as we pray and ask it in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Stand with us this morning, if you would. Again, this is just a moment If there's public business you need to do with the Lord, this altar is open. I'm here. The other ones in this room that will pray with you. But before we go back out, if God has spoken, please respond this morning as we sing. I want to say thank you for coming out this morning. I know it was a cold winter morning, so I appreciate you getting up and coming out to be with us in God's house this morning.